Hello, and welcome to this on-demand session. My name is Sean McKenna, and I'm the lead PM for the Azure Kubernetes Service. There's always going to be cases where a recommendation is missed or something goes wrong, and now you're in a state where there's a problem with your cluster, there's a problem with the applications that are running inside of it. And so we're trying to take a lot of those recommendations and best practices and apply them to doing diagnosis on your cluster as well through an experience that we call AKS Diagnostics. And so the idea here is to provide a set of self-serve troubleshooting tools built into the Azure portal, again, much like Advisor, built on top of telemetry that we have about your cluster, combined with the experience that we have from working with literally thousands and thousands of customers and the associated support cases that many of those customers have created. So what we've found is many of the support cases that customers create are ultimately root cause to something where they didn't configure their cluster correctly, or they didn't configure their applications correctly. And so we can actually identify those issues in advance and allow you to take the appropriate action to avoid having to create a support case in the first place and to get your cluster back into a good working state. So a few of the examples that you'll see in that diagnostics experience today are around pod evictions, very restrictive firewall rules, which is a common source of issues in terms of how the cluster operates, issues with DNS resolution, subnet IP exhaustion. There's a whole series of additional checks that we perform against the cluster. But I want to dig into one specifically because this has been a very common source of issues for customers and something that, again, much like pod disruption budgets, is not something that is obvious as you are learning Kubernetes for the first time, but it's something that's really critical to understand in order to ensure that your cluster operates correctly and that your applications stay available. And that is the pod evictions or kill recommendation or troubleshooting step. Now, the critical background here is to understand how the Kubernetes scheduler works. So when you provide a deployment and the associated pod specs, the scheduler is going to try to find a place to run those pods within the cluster, but it's going to do that based not on the unused capacity at the time that you're making that deployment request, so not in terms of what's actually being consumed, as you might view within a monitoring tool, for example, but based on what is unallocated within the cluster from the scheduler's perspective, so what is unreserved in terms of capacity. So when you deploy a pod and its associated containers into Kubernetes, you have the opportunity to set what's called a resource request, and that allows you to reserve a set of capacity in terms of memory and CPU and potentially other resources for that application to be able to run correctly. But that's an optional field. And so if you don't set it, then the scheduler is going to attempt to schedule more and more pods onto a given node because it doesn't actually know whether that pod requires 100 megabytes of RAM or 500 megabytes or a gigabyte. And so it's just going to continue to schedule things there. And then ultimately, as those applications attempt to run and consume more memory, they will hit the edges of what that node can actually managed to run, and so the system will then attempt to start shutting down pods to reclaim resources and ensure that the node can stay healthy. Now, there are very good use cases for that. You may want to be running some low priority pods where if there is capacity available, that they should be able to consume it. But in a lot of cases, you actually want those pods to be running continually. You want them to be remaining available. And so when they're getting killed for lack of resources, that is impacting the availability of your overall application. And so if we detect that we are seeing significant number of kill operations and evictions of pods within the cluster, that is something that we're going to surface through the troubleshooting and diagnostics tool. So just to show how some of those diagnostic recommendations are getting surfaced, let's take a look again here in the portal. And specifically this time, we're going to drill in on the Diagnose and Solve Problems menu item. And this is going to surface a couple of different buckets of potential issues. And you can see some descriptions here of the types of issues that I might be able to diagnose based on these two different buckets. So in this case, I'm going to drill in on Cluster Insights. And you're going to see that it runs a series of checks against my cluster. And again, this is based on the telemetry that we have about the operations of your cluster. And so you can see a bunch of the things that have passed here, as well as in a moment, we'll see some of the failures and warnings that I need to be concerned about. And so you can see that killed pods that we were just discussing, and I can drill in here on more info and get a whole bunch of detail about when this happened, the image that was running, the specific pod, namespace that it might have been running in, number of restarts, and so on. And so that gives me a bunch of diagnostic information that I can then go and connect to my logs and troubleshoot directly against the cluster. I'm also getting a set of pointers here out to documentation, much as we saw with the advisor and the security center recommendations. And interestingly, in this case, we're actually surfacing this particular diagnostic in two different locations. So the set of pods being killed, so obviously from a sort of a pod lens, but then also in terms of the node resources. So in this case, there's this one particular node that is seeing significant memory pressure, again, as a result of that same deployment that was not setting a resource request. And so that gives me another lens into the problem and how I may go about solving it. In fact, there's a couple of different recommendations here for what I can do next as potential action. Again, a great way for best practices to get surfaced in the context of a problem that you might be seeing in the cluster, and a way for you to learn how you can apply some of those recommendations to both get out of the current situation as well as ensure that you don't get into it again. With that, I will say thank you for attending this virtual session.